Thanks. Well, I'm here today because I love liberty. I love the Constitution designed to protect liberty, and I love my country and my state who were born to protect the liberty of its citizens. I think all of those things are in danger, and unless we take effective action soon, we're in danger of losing them all. And so the reason I'm running is because I think the Attorney General has a lot of tools in their tool chest that can help us save our liberty. And I'd like to talk about several of them in terms of the job. First, I want to talk about how the Attorney General can protect the Constitution by pushing back using the powers of the Attorney General against the federal government. I want to talk about how the Attorney General, as the chief legal officer of the state of Texas, can help get our law enforcement guys back on track. They're getting increasingly militarized. They're hostile to our open carry and other types of firearms. They don't see themselves as peace officers. And the Attorney General can do a lot. And I'll talk a little bit about that, about how we can get that situation better at hand. The third thing is the Attorney General's office is I want to make it more transparent. One of the things that I looked up one time about what the Attorney General does, and I looked at how many times the Attorney General shows up in the Texas Code, and I did a search. It was like over 800 times what the Attorney General has. It's an incredibly complex job. But one of the things that is near and dear to my heart is the Texas Open Records Act. And one of the jobs of the Attorney General is to interpret the Texas Open Records Act when there's a conflict between the citizen requesting information from their government and that particular governmental agency. In fact, the first time I ever appeared in court with my student bar card was to argue in district court because I disagreed with the Attorney General's opinion on a Texas Open Records Act request. So that's something that's near and dear to my heart. And finally, I'll just talk briefly about the fact that the Attorney General's job is really a management job. Because of the complexity of the job, the big thing that matters in terms of who your Attorney General is the fact about what they understand about the Constitution, their approach to statutory interpretation, and how good of a manager they are. There's 700 attorneys or more working for the Attorney General. There's, I think, 4,000 employees working for the Attorney General's office. And they include stuff. In fact, by the way, when I tell people I'm running for Attorney General, the most common thing that I hear back from them is that that people talk about the child payments for child care and the incredible job of enforcing against deadbeat dads and all that. There's a lot of emotion and there's a lot of improvement can be done in that area. All right, let me go ahead and start with about pushing back on the federal government. I think the most pressing thing to our liberty right now is the assault that the federal government is making on our liberties all over the country, and especially here in Texas. I mean, it's just an incredibly target-rich environment when you talk about unconstitutional federal acts. They are spying on us. They're violating the Fourth Amendment every day. The Congress has told the president he has the power to make any one of us disappear if he just declares us to be a terrorist. We don't get a phone call. We don't get our day in court. I can't think of anything more un-American than that. It is the crossing of the Rubicon and the destruction of the American Republic. And of course, if they never give you a day in court, you know, they say that the Supreme Court is the way you're supposed to win your liberty. Of course, I agree with Kathy. You're not going to get your liberty back through the Supreme Court. But with the NDAA, the National Defense Authorization Act, riders for indefinite detentions, which is what I'm talking about, you will not get your day in court. There's no way the Supreme Court's going to have a chance even to save you there. Dude, we've got to find a better way to push back. There's the groping of us at the airports in violation of the Fourth Amendment. Then, of course, we get to the economics area, Obamacare, unconstitutional, destroying our health care. We've got the EPA and a plethora of other alphabet soup agencies like OSHA and the Endangered Species Act that are targeting Texas energy, our power generation, and our ag industries. So we have this ever-tightening noose of the police state. We have, of course, the unconstitutional Federal Reserve, which is destroying our currency. and the unconstitutional spending that they're doing, which is bankrupting the nation. All of these things, we've got to figure out how to do it. And I think the Attorney General can lead the way in terms of pushing that. And let me just say my understanding of the Constitution and how why the Attorney General can do that. First, you have to understand who is the final arbiter of the constitutional meaning. Let's talk about what it says in the Constitution. Now, sometimes people, when you ask that question, they say, well, look at the Supremacy Clause. And they say, and they just imply, the Supremacy Clause means the federal government is supreme, or the Supreme Court is supreme. No, I've read the Supremacy Clause. I get it. It's right there in Article 6. It says, the Constitution and laws in pursuance thereof are supreme. It doesn't say federal government or Supreme Court is. So, in fact, nowhere in the Constitution does it say who the final arbiter is of constitutional meaning. But it does give us a clue about what the founders expected. In the very next paragraph of the Supremacy Clause, it says, and every official in government, state or federal, of all branches, including our law enforcement and our military, and in fact attorneys have to do this too, have to swear an oath to support the Constitution. Yes. Now, and in fact, in Texas Constitution, we've codified that. It says, our oath says we have to swear to preserve, protect, and defend the Constitution against all enemies, foreign and domestic. Okay? Now, I don't know about you, but if you're a law enforcement officer and you're sworn to support the law against kidnapping, you're supposed to know what kidnapping is. You're supposed to be able to identify it when you see it in reality up there in the field. And then you don't just stand by and let it happen when it happens. If you're going to honor your oath to support the law against kidnapping, when somebody is kidnapping somebody, your duty and your sworn oath says you're supposed to go stop them and punish them under the law. Well, if you're sworn to protect the Constitution, as every one of the people that are in the deal, and by the way, the military guys in this room have taken that oath, and that oath doesn't have an expiration, right? They're violating the Constitution every day in Texas, and it's our sworn duty to stop them. Now, how do we do it? It's not going to Supreme Court. Kathy gave us a hint a minute ago. If it's not constitutional, that means it's not a valid law. It's null and void. And that means they're likely to be violating some Texas law. And there's a fantastic law that works against the federal government as well as in our law enforcement thing called the Official Oppression Act here in Texas. It's chapter 39 of the Penal Code. It's a wonderful thing. I encourage you to go get on the internet and go read it. Essentially, it says if you do any kind of violate knowingly as a public servant, knowingly violate the rights or the privileges or the immunities and all, you know, all these different ways, if you violate the rights of the citizens of Texas, it's a crime. Well, I mean, when the DPS goes and cracks the ribs of AJ at the DPS, I can't think of anything more descriptive of violating rights than that. That DPS officer has knowingly violated that person's rights and is guilty of official oppression. And especially if you have an attorney general that puts law enforcement on notice about what actions are unacceptable in the state of Texas. The attorney general has an incredible power. And of course, this attorney general, the sitting attorney general, who would be our governor, Greg Abbott, is allowing all of the abuses of our firearms, open carry stuff, whether it's at the DPS or whether it's C.J. Grisham or all the others, that have been doing open carrying, or is just sitting idly by and allowing the law enforcement to do it and taking no leadership whatsoever in educating or warning our law enforcement about official oppression statute. I, as Attorney General, would do that. I will not stand idly by and allow our government to abuse the rights of the citizens of Texas. And the great thing about that public servant, it can be targeted at federal and it can be targeted at our local officials. Now, you know, one of the things that the people always say, you hear these guys when they're talking about law enforcement, well, I respect law enforcement, and I do. I respect law enforcement, too. But, man, it's like George Washington said, government is not reason, it's not eloquence, it's force. Like fire, it's a dangerous servant and a cruel master. And the guys who are on the cutting edge, who do wonder, who, if they're doing their job right, deserve our praise and our thanks and everything, you know, every kind of honor we can give them. They deserve that. But if they turn and become the agents of tyranny, we can't allow that to happen. They deserve punishment. It's a hard job, but man, we got to make sure we have our best. And we cannot allow rotten apples in a barrel, especially we can't allow leadership from the top to allow this. In addition to this just kind of general attitude we've got the federal government giving big bucks to our local law enforcement in ways that it tries to get them to be the agents of the federal government. One of the other great things that I want to trumpet is Sheriff Max, Constitutional Sheriff and Constitutional Peace Officer movement as Attorney General. And if you haven't heard Richard Max speak, I encourage you to hear him. He's the man that challenged the Clinton administration on the Brady Act. When the Brady Act said that the local law enforcement had to do background checks at their own dime or face a criminal penalty, he said no. Local law enforcement is not the agent of the federal government. He did what he says he wouldn't do now. He took it to the Supreme Court. Supreme Court, we got lucky, and they actually said no. Local law enforcement, local government, states and local governments are not the agents of the federal government. And from here forward, he says, just like I would, I'm not going to take or seek a permission from the federal government to honor my oath to the Constitution. I'm going to state what it is and then say that we won't allow that vision of the limited government to be violated in Texas. So that's my pushback on feds. I guess I've talked a little bit about how we need to do the climate on law enforcement. I've talked Open Records Act. The statute says it should be applied liberally, right? There's all sorts of ways that they are not applying the Texas Open Records liberally now. They are always come up a reason why some corporate interest or some state government needs to not divulge that interest and that information, and we just need to make sure we get that right. And finally, on management, I would just want to say a little bit about that. I haven't talked anything about me personally and my qualifications. I have worked all my life not as an attorney. I have a law license. I was persuaded by my wife late in life at age 46. I started law school. My company paid for me to go to school at night, and I finished at age 50. And I have helped Kathy pick up 5 or 6 juries and go through a number of trials. So I do have trial experience. I've done some pro bono criminal defense work. I've done some pro bono stuff. But I haven't done a career at it. But I think my unique experience of going to law school late in life allowed me not to be brainwashed by the progressive agenda that happened. One of the things which struck me when I got into law school, especially constitutional law, was the study of constitutional law in law school is not the study of the Constitution, no. It is the study of all the tricky tricks the Supreme Court has used to gut the Constitution over the last century or more. And I don't know how many times when I was in law school, I turned to my fellow students and said, I want my Constitution back. Because it's a concentrated dose of how America has died or is being killed by our federal judiciary. And that gives me a unique perspective on it. One of the things the Attorney General is asked to do every day is to do statutory interpretation, to figure out what those words in that law means. But that was one of my favorite courses in school. So I love to figure out what those words mean. There's rules actually in the statute that tell you how you're supposed to do it. And I think I can guide the lawyers in the Attorney General's office to do that. And finally, what I did have before I went to law school is I was a chemical engineering major from Texas A&M. And then I went to Harvard Business School and got me an MBA, which is, people say, is a good management school. I have trained and studied about how to manage large organizations. And then I spent most of my career at ExxonMobil, I just retired from them to help Kathy with her campaign and to work on this campaign. And I have spent 27 years in what many people have said is the best managed company in the world as well. And I have extensive management experience that I can use in this office. So I think I've got the right constitutional approach, the right statutory approach, and the right experience for the job. So that's why I'm running for Attorney General, and I'd love to take questions if you want to give it. Thanks. Yes, sir.
Okay, you said you had 27 years at Exxon Mobil. I'm sure you're familiar with the Sagebrush Lizard.
Yeah, dangerous species. Yes.
Right, so that's gone away for now, and now it's the prairie chicken.
Yes.
So what would your pushback be against the EPA?
Where in Article 1,
wildlife and all that?
Where in Article 1, Section 8, does the federal government have the authority to tell anybody to do anything with endangered species?
Yeah.
Nowhere. Mm-hmm. That means Endangered Species Act is non-void. If a federal agent tries to enforce that and stop any activity in the state of Texas, they are going to be violating Texas law, and they're violating the Constitution, and we need to stop them the same way. Now, there's one thing is the Attorney General does have prosecutors on staff, and we also the Attorney General also has law enforcement officers on staff, because there's some few things that the Attorney General on their own can go actually prosecute, primarily elections violations and that sort of thing. Every statute in the state of Texas that I know of, or at least a penal statute in the state of Texas, the Attorney General can get involved in prosecution if the local DA invites them in. And so one of the things, if you want to exercise leadership in the Attorney General's role, you develop those relationships with those district attorneys across the state, especially in the places where egregious things like you're talking about are happening, and you ask them to invite you in so that you can use the power of that office to start pushing back effectively, not to go vague. By the way, I want to tell you one thing about this approach of suing in federal government. I call the Goliad approach to that. You know, at Goliad, the tyrant surrounded them and said, "We'll give you a good treatment." So they surrendered, and they surrendered their fate to the tyrant. And the tyrant then said, "Nope, we massacre you." They marched them out and shot them all. That's essentially what you're doing when you're going to the Supreme Court. You're putting your fate in the hands of the very enemy you're trying to fight, mm-hmm. and allowing them to decide your fate. That is not an effective strategy to win our liberty. I call what Ted Cruz has been doing the Alamo approach. It's an honorable approach. It's a wonderful. You go in and you're surrounded. You fight the valiant fight. You do it, but you know that you're going to get massacred. And you get great publicity about it. You advance the ball of liberty because you change the minds of people and you rally people around you. And so I'm glad that Ted Cruz is there. You're going to hear from another candidate here, or two candidates for Senate, one of which I'm supporting, Rebecca Paddock, who I think I would love to have up there in Alamo country, or you know, in surrounded country, doing a good fight. But that ultimately doesn't win either. I think the San Jacinto approach is deciding, picking your battles of all these unconstitutional acts that are going on. You decide which one is the most popular, which one gets the most optics, where they're the weakest, and you start exercising the nullification muscle by prosecuting and pushing back effectively using nullification. That's the way we win our liberty back. So that's another perspective. Yes. Yes, ma'am.
We're currently awaiting an opinion from the Attorney General right now on the Common Core fiasco, where there are some obvious areas where, for example, Houston winning a race to the top is a violation of the House Bill 462. House Bill 5 doesn't negate, it in fact came before House Bill 462, but neither one is clear on where it stands. So they leave that open, and that's what's being interpreted wrong. We're still waiting on word on the opinion from the Attorney General. All of these testing procedures that they want to put in place for Common Core is due to go in full implementation into 2015. They're beginning it now, but it's supposed to be fully implemented by 2015. We need someone that will champion with us. We're about, so far, a little over 200 strong fighting in Texas, but we need some teeth to help fight.
Well, I mean, you've already heard a little bit about what Kathy says about that. And, of course, the Attorney General can help in this area. I mean, the Attorney General can issue opinions. You know, the Attorney General only has to respond to requests for opinions about the Constitution or the meaning of the law if requested by the governor and other officers. But in my opinion, there's nothing that doesn't say the Attorney General can't go out and state what they think is the law and what's the Constitution. And I think we need to talk about the constitutionality of this stuff, as well as be very strict in the interpretation of the statutes that are already on the books that say what the curriculum is supposed to be, and don't allow this other stuff that's coming in.
Well, we're getting rebranded. It's, you know, Huckabee said it himself. He said, you know,
don't go by the names.
Just repackage.
No, right.
And that's what they're doing. We have so many different names.
No, I agree completely. It, you know, especially in the case of Liberty for Education, Eternal Vigilance is more important than anything else, because there's a whole set of culture out there of people who are progressives who want to destroy America, who hate America, and want to destroy every love of liberty that we have, and they are working tirelessly using taxpayer money and other kinds of progressive foundation-type money to destroy our liberty, and we have to be as alert as we can be to that. There's one other thing that has outraged me in this education fiasco, and that is when you hear about Microsoft coming in and doing the Cisco, bringing the Common Core stuff in back into the local, and you hear that Ratliff is a pagan deal. I have not gone and looked at those statutes, but I guarantee you, if I'm Attorney General, one of the first things I'm doing is I'm going to have one of the attorneys there. We're going to go look at those statutes. We're going to look at the facts, and we're going to determine whether or not there's illegal activity going on. I just can't imagine that a State Board of Education official whose family is getting lots and lots of money from the establishment, mm-hmm. from all the things they're doing underneath, plus getting money from Microsoft, that person has to be violating some statutes in the state of Texas about conflicts of interest and bribery and that sort of thing. Yes.
Another quick question because of something that you said, and I don't mean this as any ill intent,
mm-hmm.
but ExxonMobil doesn't have a very good reputation amongst those of us who are
No, I agree. I agree. Most of my career.
Just for clarification.
Yeah, no, I know, because they were the ones that put money into the Common Core development along with Microsoft. Most of my life at ExxonMobil, I went through being proud of the company I worked for in terms of the way they conducted themselves in the political arena. When the current chairman came along, one of the first things that happened when the new chair came in and the Owen left is Jay Rockefeller and several other progressive senators issued essentially, you do it our way, especially on the carbon tax stuff. Of climate change stuff. You stop funding any organizations that are fighting for science or climate stuff, or we're going to cut your knees off. And that chairman blinked. And that for the first time in my life, I was not very proud of working for Exxon. And when I see them putting this money in, they've become now, at least in that way, they have, in my opinion, they have become part of the establishment that is this global elite that is working together to take away all of our liberty, and it's part of the big problem that we're facing. So I thank you very much. Yes, huh?
Yes.
They were intimidated again, too. So.
Yes, they were. Yeah. Oh, well, and you know, I know the guys there. They're just people trying to do right by in every way and trying to earn a living and produce, but they get into this political environment and they have blinked.
And I have a family member who's very high up in ExxonMobil as well. So, I understand. I thought that if this gets aired, those that are anti-Common Core, I wanted the clarification to know that your loyalty doesn't stand for ExxonMobil.
And the cool thing is, now that I'm retired, I don't have to be circumspect as I once was. So, anything else?
You mentioned that, like in your previous experience, you mm-hmm. did some work with like the pro-life and end-of-life thing. What kind of work did you do?
Well, there's a statutes. There's kind of Terry Schiavo-like statutes about taking people's life away at the end of life or when doctors. And essentially, at U of H Law School Center, they're kind of the heart of some of the professors there. Some of the heart of the guys that are the pro-death. Pro-death philosophy. They want the hospitals to decide when people die.
JPS ordeal that just...
Say again?
Kind of like this recent JPS ordeal that they got all wrote up and...
Well, you're talking about the woman who was pregnant? Yes. That's exactly what I'm talking about. And so those are just horrendous things where you have institutions with money incentives trying to take away people's lives. And we need to be pushing back on that. Greg Abbott had another chance of getting involved in that one. Mm-hmm. And their very day after they pulled the plug, he was at the pro-life rally at the Capitol instead of having taken care of that baby. And so I do care about those kinds of issues. So, all right, we have another event to get to, yeah. So I'm going to pack it up and we're going to
I'm glad y'all came.
Thank you.